We're going to be talking about where the U.S. stands in comparison to other countries that have legalized cannabis, and some of the opportunities and challenges in the domestic industry. But before we kick things off, we'll have the panelists introduce themselves and explain who they are and what they do.
Cool. My name's Kayvan Khalatbari. I'm a co-founder of Denver Relief Consulting. I've been in the cannabis industry for about 15 years, policy for the first few years, and been a regulated operator for a little more than the last decade. Founder of also Cresco Labs, which operates in 12 states now. Went public on the Canadian Stock Exchange last fall. Also have vertically integrated outside of those operations in Nevada and Ohio, and a board member with the Minority Cannabis Business Association. And we develop local, state, and now federal policy to encourage equitable cannabis industry and ownership and participation and reinvestment in the communities that have been harmed by the war on drugs.
I'm Giadha Aguirre de Carcer. I'm the founder and CEO of New Frontier Data. I am a former banker and focus much of my analysis in emerging markets on the global scale. So today, I lead New Frontier Data in making sure that this industry has the type of data and analysis and research that is trusted, that is vetted, and that can help stakeholders make responsible, unbiased, educated decisions. And I'll just keep it at that.
Hi, I'm Bryan Riley, and I'm director of the Free Trade Initiative for the National Taxpayers Union. And free trade is just the idea that as Americans, we're better off when we have the freedom to buy the best made goods and services, whether they're made in Virginia or Montana or Mexico or Canada or anywhere else.
Hello, everyone. Well, hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Chanda Macias. I have a medical marijuana dispensary, the National Holistic Healing Center in Washington, D.C. We're in DuPont Circle. I'm also a multi-state owner. We have operations in Louisiana under the name of Alera Holistic. Also, I have a hemp line under the name National Holistic Healthcare, where we are selling across the nation now. But more importantly, I wear a couple other hats representing the largest organization of women in the country under the name of Women Grow. We are having our leadership summit here June 7th and 8th to represent the women in this industry to give ourselves a voice. And I am also a board member with Kayvan with the Minority Cannabis Business Association, where we make sure our minorities are protected and have a voice as well. So thank you.
And as a reminder, after our discussion, we're going to open it up to the audience for questions, so keep thinking of things that you want to ask them. So let's get started. So I cover food and ag, and the big news in our world last year was that the Farm Bill legalized hemp. It's no longer listed as a controlled substance. So what's the significance of that development? First of all, how big of a deal is it? And you know, what does it mean in broader terms of cannabis reform?
I'll jump in here because I think the reason why it's so important, especially for minorities and women, they're less than 4% of minorities owner in the cannabis industry and less than 26% of women in the cannabis industry, period. So across the board in a workforce development aspect, in ownership, and even on C-level levels. So for us, it was important for us to get into the industry in some way. And some way that we felt protected, because as you know, that cannabis has played a bigger role in the impact on the war on drugs, where now if we're in the legalized market of hemp, we have actually a chance to start over and enter that industry and be able to start in something we quote unquote call legalized.
I'll jump in. From more of a market, macro and macroeconomic perspective, hemp has been around for 30 plus years, actually more than that, probably 60 years when you look at China. China today is the largest producer of hemp. They produce about 95% of hemp utilized for textile. And given that most of the markets outside of the United States are medical, are principally medical, and that, you know, at least research, initial research shows that you can get CBD from hemp that can be used for medical use, it meant a lot when the United States finally opened it up I opened up the hemp cultivation because it might have sort of, it would be an entry point for more medical research. All of that said, based on my, at least my understanding of what's happened recently, the Farm Bill did, it was followed by a memo that complicated things a bit in terms of the execution and the regulation. So it would be nice to have that clarified because hemp and CBD are certainly of great importance when it comes to the global market. And if the U.S. wants to participate in an active role in both the research and the trade that is occurring outside of borders, then hemp and CBD must be looked at.
Yeah, I think, you know, hemp is going federally legal is going to continue to open the door in states that don't have cannabis legalization to act as a gateway, no pun intended, into that. So at a macro level, I think in this country, it certainly broadens the conversation beyond the states that have legalized cannabis already. But from a consumer standpoint, I think it's really important because most of the CBD products that are currently sold in this country are coming or derived from hemp that is not grown in this country. And it doesn't have the oversight that I think American consumers have come to expect in any product that they ingest. And I think there was a study recently where so about 100 different products were taken that they're online available and tested and found that less than a third of them actually had the CBD content that the label said that they had. So, you know, patients in a big way, and I've known people personally that have had to deal with this, are getting swindled by buying products that simply are mislabeled, that are purposely mislabeled in a lot of cases, I have no doubt, as someone that knows a lot of folks in the hemp and cannabis industry. So I think it'll be nice to start to build that infrastructure here to allow some of the, you know, back to Chanda's point, I think it'll be unfortunate if we don't learn from some of the mistakes that have occurred in the cannabis industry. If we don't build hemp as equitable, then that's an issue, but it'll be nice to have the resources start to come into the hemp industry to be able to process this at a level that we need to make the most out of it as an industrial product, as a medicinal product. And further, I'd take a look at, back to Shauna's point again, in Kentucky, for example, there's 60,000 tobacco farmers, I believe, you know, a lot of very small farmers that, because of this, now have the opportunity to bring some life back into rural economies that aren't doing so well across the country.
And from an advocate's perspective, you know, what sort of lobbying and work needed to be done on the Hill to make this happen? Like, of all people, why is Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, like, the go-to lead on this issue?
Well, we could go back, and what Kayvan actually said is Kentucky. We had a vast amount of farmers that were losing their farms, that were actually migrating out of the state. And in order to keep them into the state and keep them somehow equitable, they had to create this industry. So yes, the industry has been created for those underlying reasons, but now it's opened up so that people can take advantage of it. Now, what's really important though is that when you think about CBD or you think about cannabinoids that are from the hemp plant and also from the cannabis plant, there's a lot of overlap, but what a lot of people are missing here is that there's still specific ailments and conditions that can only be treated with THC. And we know that through the Farm Bill, THC has to be at 0.3% or lower. So again, created a frenzy that people can actually get this true medicinal benefit, but it might not actually help them with their condition. And then having CBD that's in these products that are not regulated, again, contributing to some confusion in the marketplace.
So taking a step back, let's talk about the nature of the U.S. market. You know, what's the size of the U.S. cannabis market, and how does that compare globally?
I can take that. So the market as of 2018 in the U.S. is $10.4 billion. It has been growing. It's expected by 2025 to grow at 14% per year, compound annual growth rate. The split is about, I would say, 5.8, or about 5.8 in adult use. So the adult use portion of the U.S. market is larger than the medical use and growing faster. When you compare that to Canada, Canada today combined adult use and medical is little short of $2 billion and growing, I would say, a little slower. When you look at both markets, so look at North America overall, especially when you look at what it would look like in 2025, we're talking about $32 billion. So the growth certainly is promising. Now, when you look at the global market, and that's when the numbers start getting really material, There are 55 countries around the world that are either decriminalizing or legalizing, again, medical use primarily. And you have about 263 million consumers around the world. And that would be when you illicit and legal. Now that's about 343 or 344 billion in total potential, total addressable market. Now we're talking some large numbers. So while the US certainly is one of the most mature markets, and when you talk about things like technology and innovation, it certainly is the epicenter. Here we have 33 states that are medically legal, 10 plus DC that have adult use regulation. There is a lot happening around the world. And in fact, interestingly enough, when you look at the actual demand, in the United States, in North America, it's actually 87 billion compared to that 344 billion. And the largest market out there in terms of total addressable market is in Asia. Well, the largest number of consumers is actually in Africa. So it's an interesting onion to continue to peel as far as the true global marketplace.
And I think that is fascinating because if you were to ask me how many strawberries we imported from Guatemala in December of 1996, I could tell you the number, I could tell you the dollar volume, but when I, out of curiosity, because I'm a trade expert, not a cannabis expert, tried to figure out how much comes into the United States from abroad, there is such a wide range of estimates. And I was curious if the amount that comes in illegally currently, how it ranks compared to the fruits and vegetables, compared to the grains we import. Odds are we probably bring in more than we do of those legal goods, but that's just a little bit of a guess. And those numbers are fascinating.
These are estimates. I mean, unfortunately, anyone that tells you that we absolutely know to the penny what the illicit market size is not telling the truth. But happily, we've been doing this for now 5 years. We've actually have methodology that has shown quantitatively accurate predictions quantitatively since 2014, and this is as close as we can get. But I will say these are absolutely estimates, educated estimates based on actual real data. But it's a challenge.
And those are just sales numbers too. There's the whole economic value as well. When cannabis is legalized in these states, I think it's a 3.5x multiplier. Of other economic stimulus that happens around the regulated cannabis industry. And also, since we've started this topic of the social impact of cannabis legalization, it would behoove us to talk about what we would end up saving in the war on drugs, hopefully coming to an end here as soon as possible. That's $50 billion that we're spending as a country right now, which trumps any number that we're discussing right now with regard to the legal cannabis market.
And where in the U.S. specifically is a lot of that growth stemming from? Like what sort of regions, what sort of business structures are we seeing contribute to the explosion?
Well, probably the usual suspects. You could probably guess who those are. Obviously, California is very important. It is the eighth largest economy in the world. And one way or another, it has been active in the cannabis space and its movement since the 90s. And then, of course, then you have Colorado, one of the first adult use state that also drives. But you'd be surprised. There's some states in the East Coast that are becoming to pop up. I would say today, though, the West Coast really still drives demand. Mm-hmm. And we're beginning to see some evolution in the East Coast just recently.
And something we haven't seen come to fruition yet, something we fought for in Colorado, my office helped lead a ballot initiative in Denver in 2016 that legalized the social consumption of cannabis in hoping that we can someday get it treated similar to alcohol in the sense that we have public spaces or semi-private spaces or just places where people can congregate adults to consume cannabis. And although we have laws on the books that allow for that in Colorado in some form or fashion, California, Alaska, Massachusetts, other states, Nevada, we haven't seen anybody really step out and take the lead on that front. And that's something that often gets lost, especially when we're talking about economic equality, creating low capital opportunities, ways for people to get involved in the industry. When you get into social use and the kind of the cultural surroundings, the ancillary aspects of the cannabis industry on that front, there's a lot of economic potential there that nobody's even really talking about right now.
So changing topics, there's a major intersection of tech and cannabis. How can data and technology be used to support the growth of the industry?
How much time do we have? I'll jump in, but I don't want to be the only one talking about this. It's a very important topic. It's so important in an emerging market. emerging markets are new. There's a lot of unknown. There's uncertainty. This plant still, there's a lot to know about it. Without data, you basically have no way to understand it and no way to communicate the nuances, no way to track the progress, no way to set forth standards, no way to basically use it, sell it in a responsible and educated manner. So, I mean, data is just key. It's the blood that fuels any market, any research. So I can't speak enough about it, and not because, you know, I'm a big data service business, but it truly is important. And unfortunately, what we see in many, even mature markets like the US, even in Canada, there's yet to be enough drive to really embrace the importance of data. I mean, not to point the finger at Canada, because I think they're doing a lot of things very well, especially on the regulation portion of things. They still don't have a centralized data infrastructure to clearly communicate in a transparent and wholesome manner what's happening in their entire country when it comes to cannabis. In the United States, we have no standards, as Chanda just said. With that data, with that standard on how to collect that data and how to report that data, well, we can't come up on standards on how to use the plant and the medicine. When it comes to technology, happy to say the United States definitely is leading the way. I mean, we have been leading the way in technologies in many other aspects, why not here? So there is a lot of talent, especially when it comes to sophisticated technologies like artificial intelligence and machine learning and other things that we certainly are currently applying in trying our best when we look to turn this somewhat imperfect, fragmented and disjointed data into cohesive and intelligent and trusted reporting. So technology plays a huge role.
So I think there's also a big gap in technology here. So as an operator, what I see is that public domains or technology that is known in the public area, we cannot integrate into those systems because those companies will not allow us because we're illegal companies. And so therefore we have to create different ways, loops through different integration systems or create it ourselves. And what we find is that there's a breakdown in our technology. So when you think about the biggest, you know, cannabis state, which we could say arguably is California, and right now there's all kinds of issues about regulations, is because truly there's a lack of software and technology there to implement, to regulate that state. And so there's where the challenges start to come in with technology where we can't regulate and remain compliant because we haven't been able to find a single piece of software, even though there's some, let's say, pioneers out there that continue to lead the way, there's always these big gaps that we're constantly trying to fill and therefore create, I'm gonna say, barriers to the ease of the patient's use. And so because of that, we have all these different truncated systems, whether it is for compliance, whether it's for communications, whether if it's even for social media. As you know, we have those challenges where we can't boost posts, we can't go out and educate broad masses through any type of social media platform because we're banned. And so how do we spread the message about cannabis is medicine if we don't have a media source to do that? So again, there's numerous challenges, and you know, I look about the women in technology, and Giadha can speak to this. We're, again, less than 5% of women in technology in the cannabis space. How can we increase that? You know, what are we doing to drive those women here where we don't even have a platform nationally to say we need you to come into this industry?
And to follow up on something that Chanda said, you know, this cannabis industry is agriculture and botanical extraction, nutraceuticals, consumer product manufacturing, retail environment, patient care. It touches a lot of aspects of our cultural society. And there have been all these companies that, because major companies, even in bookkeeping or financial services or whatever, these traditional systems don't serve the cannabis industry because of the federal prohibition, that you start to see all these companies pop up providing this very, what's going to be a short-term service, because as soon as that federal legalization happens, you're going to see these major companies dive in and start to service us. But I think there's an opportunity in between there, and you do have a lot of people in tech in the cannabis industry that were willing to take risks in that nascent industry and not knowing what was going to come of it. take their time and their money and put it into that. So we're seeing them come into cannabis, and I think until that federal legalization happens, that we're actually going to see a lot of innovation happen in all these traditional spaces, and that'll hopefully feed into innovation, into traditional agriculture, into traditional consumer product manufacturing. But a lot of that's being held very tightly by a lot of people in the industry right now, because we are rapidly growing so quickly. Folks are holding a lot of intellectual property, a lot of their processes and systems very close to the vest, but even beyond that, I mean, as a medicine, you know, there's 100 plus cannabinoids in cannabis. There's, you know, scores of terpenes that we don't understand fully. So bringing science into the fold, and it is certainly endless when you bring in the creative space as well, and everything that technology is doing to tie into that. We haven't even scratched the surface, I think, of what the cannabis industry is capable of. I always like to tell folks that, you know, if we're doing things the same way a year from now as we are today, that it's going to look pretty sophomoric. It's going to look pretty silly, and that's very true. And I think the same thing is true in the tech space. So they ride along in parallel very well together, similar narratives, but I think we'll continue to see them intersect in a host of ways that can benefit society.
If I may disagree slightly, very respectfully, and mind you, also totally respectfully, and mind you, I'm also in a sort of a unique position because New Frontier Data is completely neutral and unbiased, and we really cannot take a position in movement or advocacy or other. So we kind of constrict it to what we can speak to. If we don't have data to talk about it, we basically can't talk about it, which means I can't talk about it. But in terms of two things, the woman aspect, obviously very dear to me, I am a woman. But my argument would be like, well, it is true, we absolutely need more women in technology and cannabis. I would say we need more women in technology, period.
Yes.
And candidly, definitely. In the cannabis industry, yes. We have more women in business and in leadership positions than in any other industry mm-hmm. in the world.
Yes.
And certainly in the United States. So that's something to be proud of, and it is our job, women in the industry today, to continue to mentor and create opportunities for women that do want to enter it, including in technology. And then as far as the particular mention that, you know, we do have a broken down system when it comes to technology, that may be so, but I wouldn't blame technologists or the technology sector. I would blame regulators.
Yes.
Because while we don't have a federal system, that is true, we do have state systems that could absolutely mandate more streamlined and more symbiotic solutions that would actually work well. That information, that technology, and those standards exist in pretty much every other industry. And there are many mature industries that do need to use various solutions for their various aspects. It is not the only industry where you have one solution for compliance and one solution for point of sale solution, so on and so forth. The problem is that we don't have standards and we don't have mandates and regulation that force those companies to actually speak to each other and work together.
To an extent, I mean, if I could respond to that, I mean, what we were talking about, I think, was take a Bamboo HR, for example. They are dropping cannabis businesses. You cannot get a 401k plan for your employees if you're in the cannabis industry. You cannot use a lot of these very basic things that businesses are used to using because these companies choose not to work with the cannabis industry.
Regulators aside, that creates an opportunity in the cannabis industry for that know-how to come in.
It does, but unfortunately, we're not seeing the companies step in that are appropriately responding to that in a way that is best for businesses. We are fraught with snake oil salesmen in
That's
the cannabis
true.
Industry,
it's very
and
true.
For every 10 products on the market, 9 are bullshit. To be frank,
that is unfortunate.
And we. Unfortunately, in the cannabis industry, sure, the states don't mandate it, but they also don't know any better. And it's driven a lot by industry, no doubt as well, where you do have an industry that does not work well together, that is very divided, not just on how the industry should be grown, right? You have very financially driven interests in the cannabis industry, publicly traded companies being one of those. That's one of the reasons that the Minority Cannabis Business Association, we're very fearful of federal legalization happening right now. I'm personally opposed to the States Act, right? I have businesses in 14 different states, and the States Act would benefit my businesses in a very great way. But if you cement these awful state policies that we have right now that are inequitable, that are not managing businesses appropriately, that are over-regulating these businesses in the wrong way, then we're essentially endorsing these poor state policies and allowing this big money to come in and invest in the cannabis industry and grow this inequity. It's not going to be just another or it's not going to be a different industry, I think, like a lot of us want it to. It's going to end up being just the same industry. I don't know how I got off on that tangent. But the point has to be made that there's a lot of people, whether you're a regulator or a business owner or an advocate, that are doing a huge disservice to this industry right now by really making it driven solely by money, or the liability potentially associated with jumping in the industry right now because it's not federally.
So, Kayvan, what you're saying is absolutely true, and what we haven't said is that the technology that does perform, let's say mediocre, because I think that's where we are in terms of like operators, that there is a surplus of what we have to pay for that. Even for bad technology, for a small business owner to pay the price, which we are known in the industry, you pay the marijuana tax on everything. And so where even with banking, if you have a bank account and spend $15 for your account, we're spending at least $2,000. So, and we don't get to write that off as a 280E issue. We can't, we're really subjugated. So if you think about what that looks like for a minority owner as myself that had to bootstrap my whole operation, pay out of pocket, and then I have to pay on top of that all these different marijuana taxes, how can I survive with big companies coming in and being able to just dish out this money and pay exorbitant amounts for advertisements that are not conventional, that integrate the AI technology, et cetera, that I don't have access to because I don't have the financial resources. So again, the industry is formulating to something that removes a minority, a woman from this industry and puts it back. We're not calling it big farmer now, but big cannabis. So those are some of the issues we're encountering every day.
Let's talk global competition and trade. So as we're seeing more countries legalize and decriminalize, you know, Canada just last year, to what extent does that put pressure on the U.S. to do the same?
So it puts pressure on the U.S., but really I look at the U.S. as the nucleus of what the rest of the world will kind of follow. What we will do here is really what the rest of the world will still trend. I think that we'll have the biggest market. Giadha, is that fair to say by your numbers? So we don't know yet.
I do. But please finish your thought.
So, but again, so my perception on Canada, I think we're talking about here, was a $2 billion industry where the U.S. is a $10 billion. And I think that we're still doing what we're supposed to within our confinements. Let me explain that a little bit. So you have Oregon, which has a surplus of medical marijuana. If that is legalized in comparison to a state like North Carolina that has not even started in the cannabis industry, and we create this federal legalization, all of a sudden, all California and possibly Oregon can then sell products in North Carolina where local economies cannot emerge. And so when I look at that, I have to really think about what's best for the people and the people in those states and what that looks like in terms of federal legalization and then how it will impact the rest of the world. So for me, I say let's stay here where we are, deal with our internal issues, but when the time comes, the U.S. will emerge as the biggest provider of cannabis to the world, but it's just not time yet.
So I certainly do not disagree with all of that. I'll give some facts. So the United States is by far, of course, one of the most mature and larger market today. But here's the issue. There is a big world outside of the United States, and they haven't snoozed. And they don't have the same challenge. They're not facing the same challenges that we are facing in the United States due to the cannabis not being federally legal. So when it comes to research, when it comes to import and exports, when it comes to trading with other markets, obviously, we're limited. Now with the farm bill and hemp, maybe that will change. Though when it comes just to demand, the United States has about $87 billion in demand. But well, guess what? Asia has $133 billion. So it remains to be seen sort of what the largest market will be. It remains to be seen what the role of the United States will be. And believe me, I know who I'm rooting for. So that it's not that I'm disagreeing or my heart is not in it. But from a factual perspective, the truth of the matter is that it's not as rosy as we want it to be. If we don't get our act together from a state perspective and they regulate things in a manner that allows businesses to compete and for technology to enter, and if the federal government does not get their act together and actually agrees on a way to federally regulate it and be able to give access to money and banking, and then takes a seat on the global trade space, well, the rest of the world continues to move. And they are moving very fast. Europe, I mean, even just from our perspective as running a business, New Frontier Data, the type of business we're seeing emerging from Europe versus the United States, it's not even remotely comparable. I mean, that's just one business. Mm-hmm. So I think we must be optimistic, but we must be responsible, and we must be truthful to the realities that we're facing.
Giadha, who's the number one exporter right now of cannabis in the world?
I'd say Canada. I mean, not many people are exporting, period.
Right.
And Canada is importing from Colombia, so it's really interesting.
I think it puts definitely some good pressure on us, but I think regardless of the pressure that the United States is going to federally legalize in the next 2 years, 3 years, I wouldn't be surprised if it happens in Donald Trump's first presidency still, even if it's something like the States Act passing that defers to states. But I think the point is no country has gone far enough, has like leapfrogged us to the point that United States can't catch up like that. I mean, if Canada is the largest exporter, I think I read that it's like 3,000 pounds a year that they export. My little tiny business in Nevada, and I say little tiny compared to all the others there, produces more than that every year in one business. So Canada's not exactly killing it in the export game right now. So compared to what the market size is.
That's true. But their market size is only $2 billion, so.
Yeah, and at the end of the day, I think the United States, just like it does in a lot of other consumer products, is going to set a lot of trends. I think that's why California is so important to get on board and to start bringing some professionalism and some level playing field associated with their market. Because we are going to see those consumer brands that I think are going to be known across the country, across the world, here before too long. When you look at food and clothing and all of that, I mean, the United States still does set that trend in a big way, and I don't think cannabis is going to be any different personally. So regardless of what we have as far as our internal consumption and those numbers associated with it, I would agree that I think we're going to export a great deal because this is where brands are made.
I think an earlier panel mentioned laboratories of democracy. And when I grew up, I thought about the 50 different states as 50 laboratories of democracy. But I think your question reminded me that each country gives us an opportunity, whether it's with respect to this policy or in economics, do you want to be North Korea or South Korea? It's not just a theory. You can look and see at what works. So I don't know how much of it is, some of it's putting pressure on us probably, but some of it, as somebody who's kind of on the outside, is, well, we can see what other countries are doing, and does it seem to be working or not? Is it catastrophe? Is it fantastic? And then hopefully we can learn from that.
I'll add something, not to be argumentative.
Please.
We entered the business. I found the company in 2014. Okay, May of 2014 is when I first heard about cannabis. I mean, I didn't even think pot, which is what we still called it ignorantly at the time, was a market or a business. And it was because Maryland had just announced that they were going to put out licenses. We've been tracking since 2014 to now the evolution of the United States from an industry. And I cannot disagree with you in terms of everything that you said, but I will bring attention to this. In half of the time, 55 countries have come to market. So I'm just saying we need to be, I agree with everything you said, but it doesn't hurt. You know, as a company, we take great pride in reporting the good, the bad, and the ugly. And it sucks sometimes to have to be the one to talk about the ugly. But I do think that we do absolutely have to be cognizant of what's happening outside of our borders, despite the fact that we absolutely are at the peak and the forefront today. But let's make sure we are at the forefront tomorrow, too.
And just one more question before the audience. I want to talk about the state-by-state legalization approach. How has that impacted international trade?
Well, because we can export, import, et cetera, it hasn't helped, has a direct impact. But what we'll see is a lot of American-based companies are now exchanging on the Canadian exchange and going public that route. So we do know that that has impacted in terms of when we look at the global perspective and why everyone's going public on the Canadian exchange. But I still will say that as we emerge internally, we're still rising pretty strong with our infrastructure. We see that from state to state, the licenses used to be opened up to maybe 20 or so. Now they're reducing down to 5. Some states are just 2. So again, it's like, because the sophistication of the technology in terms of growing and being able to form, I'm gonna say these different, some states diopolies or multi-state operators are kicking in, that really we're getting a lot more sophisticated, and therefore when it's time where we do go federally legal, it will switch back over into the United States. And when we're exchanging publicly on the US exchange, it's gonna be ginormous. But we're just using Canada as our playing ground, as a bad word to say, that we're gonna bring it back home when it's time. It's just that we don't have that ability right now.
Right now, Canadians are being precluded sometimes from coming into the United States if they're in the cannabis industry up there, if that's what they're putting it at the border as the reason for coming over here, that they're in the cannabis industry, which is unfortunate. Far more unfortunate is the fact that it's really negatively impacting legal immigrants in this country. You have folks that are legal immigrants that are working in the cannabis industry that are getting deported. This just got a light shined on it in Colorado in a big way, and is no doubt happening in other parts of the country, especially as California and Florida build their markets. I think you're gonna see that become an even larger problem. But also looking at the, you know, even our state-by-state framework that we have, it's put a lot of pressure on cannabis illegally coming into the country. I mean, there's been endless stories done about the kind of Mexican influence in cannabis in the United States is pretty much, I mean, it's still there, but it's a heck of a lot less than it was before Colorado and Washington kicked off legalization. So it impacts it in a lot of ways, but I go back to really, truly believing that in the next 2 to 3 years, we're going to have federal legalization in the United States, and all of it, you know, it will serve as that laboratory for democracy, that these different states, they're all messing up right now. None of them are regulating appropriately. Even a state like California that has had the previous examples of a couple dozen states to try to get this right is proving in their implementation right now that they're failing miserably to accomplish everything that they want to in the time that they want to. So it's probably pretty good at the end of the day that we're having all of these mistakes made and all these states get out in front and start to test how we actually are going to regulate this at the federal level when the time comes.
So I do have a comment, and you know, you said something that actually, you know, struck home with me. So when you think about policies that are formed that keeps one population, a vulnerable population, oppressed, like immigration, where even immigrants or permanent citizens that have that designation here in the United States, that once they work in the cannabis industry, can lose the possibility of citizenship and even be deported. Again, these are the policies that oppress communities. So I think about, again, why aren't minorities in this industry? It's because we've had policies against our population to keep us out. And we still haven't had those policies removed. So then that's why you see this small little number of minority participants, because it's a broad generalization of policies that affect us. If you're on public housing and you consume cannabis with the card, you can lose your public housing. So again, why are we targeted? And I say that because this is my community. You know, this is what we represent. I think about my mothers that have given their children medical marijuana so that they could literally live, and they have had their children removed from them. Why are you targeting mothers? Like, how can you even question a mother's willingness to save her child's life when there's something that works for them? So don't target vulnerable populations. This is a time where we need to push back and think about, all right, give us our rights and entitlement and the equal playing field so we all can participate fairly.
On that note, do we have any questions out there from the audience? There's the mics, I think, on both sides.
Can't see.
Hello? My question is, do you all see cannabis science being entered into the STEMs for academic purposes in the school systems starting in middle school? In my mind, I'm looking at middle school and high school, because I went to a land-grant institution that has an accelerated program for the high school into the college classes and courses for STEMs. I feel like cannabis science being integrated into the STEMs in the school system will be able to keep America keeping up with the rest of the world. Do you all see that coming, or?
Definitely, and I'll speak a little bit on that. So the Harlem Business Alliance is honoring me on May 1st for my work in STEAM education. So that is science, technology, engineering, arts, and mathematics. Now, why is a black organization of business owners saying that I would be awarded? Because by profession, I'm a biomedical researcher. And I do believe in a former director of STEM education at Howard University. So do you know that there are only 9 medical schools in the country that will educate physicians on the endocannabinoid system? And so now we have to bring that education not only from a physician level, but incorporate it so the patients know how to use this medicine, how it impacts their bodies, because those are the things that we don't know. So when I think about STEM education or STEAM, it is imperative that it's a part of our basic learning, like sex education. We think about what we're taught about different forms of medicinal medicine. This is just another extension of it and should be respected as such.
Great question.
Hey, so the panel has been talking a lot about marijuana exporting from the United States. Historically speaking, the United States has exported the drug war. Our policies have been copied by other countries, largely because we've forced them to do so. Also, historically speaking, the US has gone into other countries, such as the Philippines, South America, and forced our capital into their countries. Our businesses have taken control of their economies because we have inherent advantages. When talking about cannabis legalization, it would be really unfortunate for us to legalize cannabis and then force other states to do that and then not allow them to build their own investments and instead start exporting cannabis and have our companies taking over their markets. How can we effectively advocate for regulations that would prevent that, that would allow them to build their own equity rather than us just exporting to them?
I think it's one of the conundrums that we're dealing with right now. I would love for cannabis to be legal today in this country so that 550,000 people are still going to jail every year for simple cannabis possession don't, right? That is, even as we're talking about all these dollars that are being made in the cannabis industry, we are not talking about the more than 500,000 people that still go to jail every year. Often in the cannabis industry, they don't talk about it. I know you do, James. I know I do. But unless we, and this is why what I think we do at the Minority Cannabis Business Association is so important, is we want to thwart federal legalization or the STATES Act from passing unless it has equitable language in it right now, unless it has reinvestment priorities set for communities that have been harmed by the war on drugs right now. That has to happen before that legalization happens. And I would hope, if that does happen, if we're able to win that fight, that that's a precursor to that larger conversation that you're talking about, because we did create prohibition. The United States created it for the world. You know, we did push those policies down their throats and require these people to do it for a myriad of reasons. I'm sure you could probably talk to that about some of the trade issues. But unless we start at home here and actually look in the mirror and fix that first, I think it's going to be very difficult for this industry to be anything different than all of these other extractive corporate industries are in how United States companies behave across the world, unfortunately.
And I think it's important to get it right right off the bat, because what I've seen from trade policy is once you get a bad policy in place, it's hard to get rid of. If you were going to start from scratch, a lot of times these policies would never be put in place. Like in the United States, we pay about twice the world price for sugar because the sugar producers in Florida are very politically powerful. So if you're a candy manufacturer, you have to move to Mexico or Canada to get your sugar to be competitive on the world market. So it'll be very fascinating to see how it shakes out, how much is produced in the US versus abroad. I don't have some of the same concerns maybe that some people do about foreign investment. I know looking at Colombia, for example, American investors created the opportunity for them to grow and sell flowers to the United States, and I view that as mutually beneficial under the right framework. Like that framework's really important, and I would just say it's important to try and get it right from the start.
So I'm gonna jump in because we're talking about policy again. I think I demonstrated how policy has oppressed different communities here. So when you think about your question in a greater sense, how are we gonna affect the policy that you would like to see implemented? Well, one, we don't have the power. Two, we don't have the influence, and we don't have the power influence because we don't have the money. So again, we have to find a grassroots approach to participate and be a part of these programs when legislation is being created, where policy is being created, but a lot of us are just not aware that we can be participants in that. So that is definitely a grassroots approach so that we can have, as Kayvan said, like for example, the States Act. If we had some type of policy to represent minorities in that, that would be wonderful for us. But we have to fight for that. They're just not gonna give it to us. And that's why we have to come together and say, look, we're looking for these things to be incorporated. So if you could tell us how to do it, maybe the people in this room that are watching this will start to take that and become active so it won't impact other people or populations that it will directly hurt.
We just have time for one more quick question.
So a lot of this panel talked about legalization as the key to kind of this industry growing, but I actually feel like education for patients and physicians is really the key to make this market really exponentially grow. If you think about all the patient populations out there that don't even understand how this medicine can be used therapeutically, and you think about the patients that actually need this medicine every day, large amounts of it, and some of them for the rest of their lives, don't you think that education, science, research is really the key to kind of growing this market?
Definitely. Yes. I can't even start to say how important that is. So when we think about Washington, D.C. and the dispensaries here, I can say I hold the market. Why? Because we focus on that education. The education of one ailment that is aligned to a particular strain and form of medicine. Each patient has to physically opt in into being educated and consulted on their condition to know that they're being treated for something specific. This is real medicine and should be respected as that. But because there is the lack of education, as we heard previously, this is why there's a big gap and patients are not being treated the way they're supposed to. So the education needs to be there. The problem is that it's not respected.
Well, one of the issues is chicken or egg thing too. Without legalization, we can't get the institutions, I think, that we would normally expect to do this kind of research in the United States on board with doing it, right? If they do, they generate these sidecar nonprofits that are often ill-funded, or they get funded by some big player in the cannabis industry that manages somehow to maneuver that study into their own personal gain or financial gain that they have. So we really need that legalization to come. Unfortunately, I think when that does happen, as we've been talking about, then you have large money flood in, and just like we've seen in the pharmaceutical industry, the research really is almost not as important because the money is more important. They use research as an excuse to continue funneling money and to charge more for the drugs that they have. We need to find a different way of doing things. We can't continue to go the same route and allow the same institutions to manage the research that we're doing on cannabis that are currently controlling our pharmaceutical system. And if we go to legalization right now and allow the people that are controlling the cannabis industry right now to be the people that have that opportunity, they're going to do everything they can to recreate that system. They're going to do everything to lobby to keep other people out of the marketplace and for them to maintain their market share, unfortunately. So we got a lot of work to do before we can legalize or do, I think, the research that we all want to see done.
If I may, I could not echo his sentiments more. Education without information, yes, finally. Education without information, which we won't get without legalization, is basically, it's that, this lack of it. And it is really a chicken and egg situation. I mean, we collect information. Our whole mandate and mission is literally to educate. Unfortunately, if the stakeholders are not willing to share their information, if the state doesn't mandate or at least encourage that share of information, then those of us who are trying to educate and share good intelligence doesn't have anything to work with. Yes, well, I think your sentiments are in the right place. Unfortunately, legalization is likely the catalyst to accomplish what you speak of.
Thanks so much for a great discussion. I certainly learned a lot, and I hope you all did too.
Caroline Phillips couldn't be here to say goodbye to everyone. She's obviously got a big day tomorrow. But just wanted to end and thank you all for coming to the National Cannabis Policy Summit. This is why I've come out here the last 4 years instead of staying in Denver, because frankly, I'm tired of stereotypes being perpetuated in Denver. People getting baked in the grass and throwing trash everywhere isn't the kind of cannabis industry I want to see. So I love the week of activism, advocacy, entrepreneurship, and all of that that comes along with the National Cannabis Festival and now the Policy Summit. And I hope to see you all out at the RFK Fairgrounds tomorrow. So thanks for coming.
I couldn't be more delighted to be here at this year's National Cannabis Policy Summit. I'd like to thank Caroline Phillips and the team for organizing this extraordinary conversation around cannabis in our society, and to think that we're just a couple of blocks away from the Capitol, debating, discussing the future role of America in this emerging global cannabis economy is a reflection of just how much things have changed in the past few years. I'll use my brief remarks today to talk about the environmental impact of cannabis, but for those of you who don't know us, some context might be helpful about the perspective we bring to this conversation. In 2014, our prescient founder, Giadha Aguirre de Carcer, recognized that despite how quickly the cannabis industry was poised to grow, there was very little data about it, and what little data there was about it generally wasn't very good. So we've spent the past 4.5 years building arguably the industry's largest repository of information, intelligence, and insights into the cannabis industry. We've looked at capital and investment flow, the rise of the cannabis consumer economy, innovation around products, operational costs, including things like energy use, and the social impact of prohibition, and what all of these aspects of the industry that we've studied have done is give us a robust, holistic perspective on the trajectory of this industry. And that's going to inform my perspective today. To understand the scale of the impact of cannabis, you must understand the size of the industry. Globally, there are 263 million cannabis consumers in the world today, who collectively spend nearly $350 billion on cannabis each year. The legal market, which currently is less than $20 billion, is the very tip of a very, very large iceberg. And I hope that helps contextualize the scale of the opportunity that lies ahead already, as well as the additional value that can be created based on all of the new ways in which people are innovating around cannabis. Over 60 countries around the world have now legalized cannabis in some form, whether that's for industrial use, whether that's medicinal use, or for full adult use. And there are a number of factors, forces that are converging to drive this change. Two points in particular are worth calling out. One is the advancing science around cannabis as therapeutic use, with the UN, the World Health Organization, the EU, and now the US National Academies of Sciences, all completely affirming the therapeutic value of cannabis. It's made it much more difficult to argue for blanket prohibition when it does improve the quality of patients' lives. And then second is the innovation and the potential new applications that cannabis represents. Because as we're discovering these new ways in which cannabis can be used, what it's doing is drawing in a broader coalition of stakeholders who are looking to capitalize on this opportunity and therefore advocating for expanding access to the plant. All of this growth is presenting significant both challenges and opportunities. How does an industry that is growing this explosively mitigate the ecological impact associated with cultivation? Reduce the amount of energy used to grow the plant, and lower the amount of post-consumer packaging that's ending up in our waste systems, while also capitalizing on all of the new opportunities to innovate about, around cannabis. Integrate this plant into sustainable development programs, and through bioremediation, environmental cleanup, undo some of the damage that has been done by decades of unchecked growth. Legalization is already reducing the ecological damage associated with growing cannabis. This has been a major issue in places like California and elsewhere, where in the illegal market, people have used fertilizers and pesticides in an unchecked way, and it's created enormous environmental damage, not only in the places where this is happening, but downstream as the watersheds have transported those chemicals into other communities. With legalization, California has been able to regulate which pesticides and fertilizers are used, thereby dramatically reducing the ecological damage from cultivation. Energy use has been another driving concern within cannabis. You know, the combined cultivation of cannabis, both in the legal and illicit markets, each year consumes 4.1 million megawatts of energy. That's equivalent to the annual output of Hoover Dam. But with the capital being introduced by cannabis legalization, as new investors are rushing into the space, there's now the financing and the incentive to innovate that's enabling growers to build these new, very technically advanced cultivation facilities that leverage both natural and artificial light, that use automated systems to ensure that the optimal growing conditions are being maintained for the plant, and critically, that are dramatically lowering the environmental, the energy use from growing cannabis. This is such a major issue that the companies that are able to dramatically address their energy use today will be very, very well positioned to compete in an increasingly competitive environment, given that energy use is the second highest expense amongst cannabis growers. It turns out that Americans have a prodigious appetite for cannabis. Just in Colorado alone, over the past 4.5 years, they've sold 1.3 billion pounds of flower. That's equivalent to nearly 2 billion joints. Now imagine if each of those joints had to be packaged because either regulations require that cannabis products be in child-proof, safe packages, or because the companies that have made those products want to differentiate each other on store shelves, so they're using packaging, their packaging as a way to do that. It certainly does make for distinct products, but the amount of waste being generated from packaging once it's being used is a very significant concern. Take that a step further. The popularity of disposable vapes has grown dramatically over the past few years, in part because they're discreet, they're convenient, and increasingly they're very, very well produced, so consumers can have a consistent, replicable experience. The issue is that not only do all of these disposable vapes create a lot of packaging that needs to be disposed of, they also present the risk now of ending up in landfills with all of these components that aren't being reused. And this is one of the issues that the cannabis industry has an opportunity to innovate now before it builds the massive scale that will come as you start seeing markets like New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Illinois, and Ohio advancing toward advanced adult use legalization, which is certainly, you know, much more plausible within the next 2 to 3 years. But for all of these challenges that the industry is facing as it launches, as it grows and matures, there's also huge opportunity to innovate with this cannabis plant. You know, we've heard cannabis described as the most versatile crop in our agricultural economy, and I can understand why. It's highly nutritious for both humans and animals. It produces textiles. It can rival cotton with using half the water, while also producing one of the strongest naturally occurring plant-based fibers. It can be used in building materials and for construction applications, and increasingly it's being used in applied materials like bioplastics, which luxury car makers like BMW are integrating into their latest vehicles. All of this from one plant. As legalization continues to expand, one of the things that's going to happen is that there's going to continue to be investment and innovation in all of these areas and many more, thereby increasing the total value that cannabis will represent in our global economy. A final thought. This is a plant that flourishes around the world. It flourishes outdoors. And so as we begin to think about the ways cannabis can be leveraged to create value and improve the quality of the lives in our own communities, we should also be thinking about ways it can be used to improve the quality of lives of people around the world. Because the reality is, the perilous future that we face with the hazard of global warming will take highly collaborative, unselfish approaches to building innovative solutions that will mitigate the continued expansion of climate change. But also, there's a huge opportunity for cannabis to play a role in bringing back some green to this planet. A few closing thoughts. Legalization is already helping reduce the ecological impact of growing cannabis. And now the race is on to innovate new ways to reduce energy use and grow cannabis as efficiently as possible. Regulators must give a lot of thought to how their requirements for packaging cannabis, because as we see the demand continue to accelerate, as we start to see greater encroachment into this $350 billion market, there's got to be more consideration given to the amount of post-consumer waste being generated. And similarly, the industry must start to innovate new ways to ensure that there can be reuse and recycling of increasingly disposable or single-use products. Cannabis's versatility will provide extraordinary opportunity for innovation over the next few years, and the people who are able to find and build effective solutions today will be sitting at the vanguard of one of the greatest economic and wealth creation opportunities of our generation. But to be clear, the decisions we make today will define the future of this industry tomorrow. And it is imperative that, as this industry grows, environmental concerns are at the heart of our decision making. I'm pleased to announce that we've just released or announced the release of our global report, which covers this and many other issues that we're exploring. The report is free. It will be available on Monday. So please visit newfrontierdata.com to gain access to it. And enjoy the conference today. Build connections that I hope will help lead to a more constructive, thoughtful, and comprehensive solution as we as a country and as we as a global community advance to a legal, regulated global cannabis economy. Thank you very much.